This evening on the Rock Newman Show, I sit down with fitness enthusiast and doctor of physical therapy, Ivan Hernandez. Dr. Ivan discusses how despite having an ideal physique and only 6% body fat, stress from marriage and financial woes caused him to have a heart attack at just 38 years old. Now recovered and with his health on the upswing, Dr. Ivan will discuss keys to achieving optimal health and wellness, along with his new book, Courage to Continue. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Dr. Ivan is a man who's fit, who's fun, and who's dedicated his life to helping others reach their health and fitness goals. But behind his smile and mission is a man whose life was nearly cut short by a broken heart. At age 38, and at the height of his health and fitness journey, Dr. Ivan suffered a heart attack, the result of financial struggles and a stressful divorce, scarred by infidelity. Now age 40 and on the road to recovery, Dr. Ivan has rediscovered his purpose, redefined his goals, and repositioned himself as a person and professional. He joins me now to discuss how his traumatic experience shaped his life and physical therapy practice, and he'll also share his five pillows for health and wellness found in his new book, Courage to Continue. Dr. Ivan, welcome to the Rock Newman Show.
Thanks for having me.
This heart attack. I don't know why, but I have this picture in my head of the Richard Pryor video talking about his heart attack. I don't know if you've ever seen that.
I haven't.
I'm going to suggest that
I got to take a look at
that. You take a look at it. Because Richard Pryor talks about this incredibly excruciating pain, and his heart was talking to him.
Yeah.
His heart was talking back to him. I'm going to make it so you can't breathe right now. You shouldn't have been eating all that pork. and it is absolutely hilarious, but enlightening and illuminating.
Yeah.
I would like to start at the heart of things and talk about your heart attack.
Yeah.
First of all, talk to me how it was physically. What physically did you experience?
It was a typical day. It was on a Friday, the end of May of 2015. It was May 30th. And it was a typical day at work.
An anniversary, a heart attack anniversary date coming up.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. It's going to be the 2-year anniversary date. That's right. And so nothing remarkable happened at work. I was unscathed by my day-to-day experiences working with patients, documentation, and whatnot. Then I went home and ritualistically got into my exercise mode. You know, I put on my gym clothes, I put food away to cook or to marinate for later on during that evening. I went to work out. I'm a heavy lifter. I lift heavy weights. It's powerlifting is one of my mainstays in terms of maintaining my fitness level. During that particular workout, I did have some level of discomfort, but I chalked it up to it being warm in the basement where I work out with a good friend of mine, in the basement.
You say discomfort? Was that discomfort in the chest?
In the chest. Mm-hmm. And but again, I thought nothing of it because, visibly, I was healthy. Yeah. And even going beyond that, even putting on the cap of a clinician, you know, one of a big risk factor is genetics, is family history. Mm-hmm. And I had no remarkable family history. Mm-hmm. In fact, just a couple months prior, I had gone to my doctor for routine blood work, and again, everything was unremarkable. So when I had that slight chest pain that night, I thought nothing of it. Mm-hmm. Went home, I cooked, I ate. The pain persisted. And I attributed that pain at that point to the garlic chicken that I had made. Mm-hmm. I had put a lot of garlic. Mm-hmm. Big fan of garlic.
Pretty little indigestion.
That's right.
And bad breath.
That's what I thought. Yeah. I thought it was indigestion. Mm-hmm. That's what I had attributed to. So went to bed. And again, it was just a typical sequence of events from the day before to the morning of. But that particular morning, things were a little different.
The next morning.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, I went through my night rituals, brushed my teeth, showered, got ready for bed, went to bed, slept through the night, mm-hmm. Got up a couple of times to use the bathroom, but otherwise it was an unremarkable night. Mm-hmm. But that morning, when I woke up, there was a heightened state of awareness. It was just an odd thing to describe. I had this feeling of pending doom, where I was in a survival state. And normally I would be conscious or conscientious of how I would leave my house. I would dress up, I would dress neatly at the very least, even if it were to go to a supermarket. But this particular morning, I distinctly recall just grabbing any set of pants, putting on a scrappy t-shirt, mm-hmm. and rushing out the home. And so again, I was using this primitive brain hardwired to keep me alive. And it's so hard to explain it. I just kind of mm-hmm. went through it. And I've heard of this before. Mm-hmm. And here I was going through this protective mechanism designed to keep me alive. And so I left my house, got into my car, and there was a series of very pivotal decisions that I had to make upon leaving my home. I could have went to a very local store and got some indigestion meds, because again, I chalked it up to it being sure. indigestion. Yeah. Or I could have made a left at the bottom of my hill. I live on the top of a hill. Have driven a mile and go to CVS. And again, there was no really strong thought, any good reasoning as to why I chose to make that left, but mm-hmm. I did nonetheless. Mm-hmm. And that was a pivotal decision, because I went to CVS about a mile in the other direction, and the symptoms had escalated so badly that I distinctly recall, while being in CVS, I was drinking the indigestion meds while in the aisle. Mm-hmm. And I remember an associate asking me, are you okay?
Right.
And just raising my hand, giving them that
universal. So what were you feeling at that point?
Strong chest pain. Strong chest pain, difficulty breathing,
pressure,
arm pain.
Chest pain, is that pressure, is that sharp pain?
Deep gnawing pain.
Deep gnawing.
Deep gnawing pain beneath my breastbone. But what made that experience so profound in retrospect is that just across the street from that CVS, there was an urgent care facility
okay.
that opened up at the very time that I chose to have left my house. Mm-hmm. So upon exiting CVS, I said, you know what, instead of going home, let me just go to the urgent care. And at that point, just by crossing the street, the symptoms had escalated even more. Mm. The urgent care doctor came in, did an EKG, and lo and behold, he told me, you're having a heart attack.
Having a heart attack.
You're having a heart attack. Uh-huh. I'm in the middle of a heart attack. So it's in retrospect, the stars were aligned that particular morning, because had I chosen to make a right, mm-hmm. I would have probably went home and probably perished. I probably wouldn't be here today speaking with you. I probably wouldn't have written this book. So it was interesting how things played out, but it was an eye opener, and it made me realize that health and wellness goes well beyond just diet and exercise. Mm-hmm. You see, I've always, for all of my life, and certainly all of my adult life, I've always been a proponent of being fit, and I've always synonymized being well with being physically fit. Mm-hmm. But this experience made me realize that wellness encompasses a lot more than just physical fitness.
Mm-hmm. And you know, before we broaden it, and we will.
Yeah.
I want to stay with the experience.
Yeah.
So you're now in the urgent care place. Mm-hmm. Doctor takes EKG, tells you you're literally in the middle of having a heart attack. What next?
So he called the ambulance. The ambulance came 2 minutes later. In the interim of all this, I had called my brother, who's a nurse practitioner, who had told me earlier that morning when I did call him to go to the emergency room. Again, another classic feature of someone going through a heart attack. I had denial. I denied the possibility of something grave going on with me because how could this happen to me? Someone who is fit, 6% body fat, eats a paleo-based diet, and has no family history. So I said, you know what? I think it's indigestion, right?
You don't want to overreact.
I don't want to overreact. Right. You never want to do that. And I tell everyone that I come across at this point forward, never underestimate, all right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's better to be safe than sorry.
In this particular case, very much error on the side of caution.
Absolutely. Okay. So 2 minutes later, the ambulance comes. They take me to a local hospital. And again, it was a-
You conscious?
I'm aware, I'm conscious. In fact, I was on the phone. I told my brother that I'm going to a local hospital. And I get into the hospital. And as I'm arriving, my brother's walking in at that very moment. Mm-hmm. He's always been there for me.
Yeah.
And so it was very apropos for him.
Beautifully described in this book. Right.
Very apropos for him to have reached the hospital that very moment we're going in. I'm on the gurney and he runs to me.
Yeah. And literally and symbolically, your rock.
My rock.
My
rock.
He is.
He is. Big brother Ray. And they do a number of other tests, they do some blood work, and they confirmed that I am in fact having a heart attack. Mm-hmm. And then at that point I had to make a decision because I needed an immediate procedure, a stent procedure. I could have either stayed in the hospital or I could have went to New York City, Columbia Presbyterian, where they have a facility and the resources to carry out the procedure that I needed.
Sure.
Again, very fortuitously, just a month prior, that local hospital had implemented a catheterization lab. Mm-hmm. It's a lab where they diagnose and treat occlusions in the heart. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what happened to me. What makes it even more fortuitous is that my brother, a nurse practitioner, works in the cath lab in Columbia Presbyterian.
Yeah.
The very same staff that was in that local hospital that morning.
Yeah.
So
stars lining up.
I'm telling you. So that decision of whether or not I'm gonna stay local or go into the city was made a lot easier for me.
Sure.
I'm gonna stay local.
Yeah.
I had the procedure. It was fairly routine.
Uh-huh. Now you said occlusion. Occlusion?
Occlusion.
What? Tell us what that is.
An occlusion is an obstruction that blocks flow of blood to a particular area of the heart. Mm-hmm. And when blood flow ceases, you develop what's called an infarction. So the technical name for a heart attack is a myocardial infarction, where blood stops flowing to a particular part of the heart, it becomes hypoxic, deprived of oxygen, and then the tissue, if left untreated long enough, it undergoes necrosis, it breaks down, and it no longer functions. Mm-hmm. So I had the procedure, and fortunately it was a good procedure. It was a successful procedure, and I was able to have a favorable recovery. I did cardiac rehab. I took everything seriously.
One more thing.
Go ahead.
One more thing, because I want to stay very basic here.
Yeah.
You said you had a stent procedure.
Mm-hmm.
What's a stent?
A stent is a device that they use to open up the lumen, the space in the vasculature, in my particular case, an artery in the heart, mm-hmm. so that blood could flow through.
Okay.
So it's a way of just removing the occlusion in order that you get blood flow to what would have otherwise have been led to a grave condition, mm-hmm. my death.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the purpose of the stent, and that's the stent that I had. It was in a, and what makes my particular case interesting is that what the diagnostic showed is that my heart was otherwise very healthy. Mm-hmm. I had single vessel disease. Mm-hmm. It was just one particular vessel that was involved, the circumflex artery.
Mm-hmm.
But what makes it astonishing is that typically when you see someone having heart disease, you see systemic involvement of the heart, multiple arteries undergoing plaque formation and limited blood flow to certain areas. But in my case, what made it an aberration, mm-hmm. at least that's what four cardiologists summed up, was that it was in a single vessel.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's something to be said about that. There's something to probe. Why a single vessel? Why not systemic? Why in someone mm-hmm. with an otherwise healthy history, mm-hmm. unremarkable family history?
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what made me kind of probe into wellness a little more.
Mm-hmm.
And really, that unequivocally led to me getting a better understanding and was the very basis of the five pillars of
okay.
wellness.
All right. Now, so you've given us the experience.
Yeah.
That's a tough one, man.
It was scary.
Pain?
The pain was excruciating. It slowly ramped up.
Mm-hmm.
It slowly ramped up and it got to the point where I needed pain meds. But even the pain meds, when they were administered, were short-lived.
Mm-hmm.
I remember distinctly after the procedure, I felt great.
Yeah.
I felt awesome afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
The pain had gone away.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now, so here you are the quintessential guy that this should not happen to.
You would think.
So now you've taken us through the procedure. I think we got a good glimpse of that difficulty. Now, if you could help us understand what you've determined and what you talk about here in the book, and maybe we'll even go deeper.
Yeah.
In the introduction to this segment, we said that it was financial woes that you were burdened with and a most unfortunate infidelity experience in your marriage.
Yeah.
Let's talk about both.
Okay.
You were having financial struggles. Were your financial struggles related to your attempting to develop your business?
Wow, there's so much to say about that. I could give you the backstory.
Okay.
In 2006, I remember running a race, a Tunnel to Towers race, in commemoration for what happened on 9/11.
Yeah.
And I was with my brother and my best friend. And I was running that race, and I remember after the race, feeling something funny in my foot. I thought nothing of it, but the swelling persisted. It was swelling that I had noticed. and then days afterwards, what I started to notice, days and weeks afterwards, is that every time I would remove my socks, I would see an indentation. And I remember going to my primary care physician and he attributing it to my profession, that I stand a lot. Fortunately, I did my due diligence. I was guided by my brother also at the time, again, my rock. And I sought out a nephrologist, and which is a kidney doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that the swelling would have been attributable to either, there are a number of possibilities, but either cardiac or kidneys. So I went to a nephrologist, I had a biopsy, and this is all in 2006. And the biopsy came out positive for a very rare DNA abnormality. It's called C1Q nephropathy. And pedal edema or swelling of the feet are one of the features in C1Q nephropathy. And it was around that time where I think at the time my son was five. My wife was pregnant with my second son. And I had decided that what would be best for my family unquestionably would be to secure a life policy. But because of my condition, I could not secure a life policy. I tried five times and I was denied every single time. So as per my financial advisor, as per the advice of my nephrologist, he said, essentially, your health is your wealth. As long as you stay alive, as long as you stay fit, you could accumulate wealth, and that is what you're gonna pass off to your children. So when I opened up my first practice in 2006, things went swell. It was, my business grew exponentially. I started hiring within months. Things went so well that I sought out business advice and thought that I could monopolize a particular geographical area. So I decided to open up a second office 3 years later. And for the most part, that went well too. It wasn't until about a year or two later that I realized that the biggest struggle, and I think most business owners would agree to this, is that the biggest struggle was staff, managing staff.
Personnel.
Getting reliable, proficient staff members that really cared and wanted to provide a service. It's a, you know, my profession is a community-based service industry, and you just had people that wanted to do it.
You got it one-on-one.
Dealing with people, dealing with personalities, dealing with pain and irritability that go along with each other. And I just, I started having trouble about two years after the second office. And I had made a mistake.
Now we're about 2011, 12.
2011. But in procuring that office, I had made a legal mistake, a huge legal pitfall that I actually talk about in the book that I would never ever do again. But I signed a personal guarantee. And with me having struggles that started to escalate, staff struggles, I decided that I would let that one go. There was a point where I was negotiating three offices. I decided that I would let that one go, but because of the personal guarantee,
You're on the hook.
I was on the hook.
Yeah.
And so, as expected, we ended up going to court. And while that was going on, it was wow. I'm fast forwarding now to 2014. So I nonetheless maintained that office despite having some staffing issues. But what was interesting is that while that was happening, I learned of my personal issues.
Let me just ask you this. So you're having this struggle here, and you clearly are stressing.
There's no doubt. This was a huge source of stress. This was a huge source of stress. And I talk about it. It was the monster that I didn't want to face. It was a monster that I didn't want to face, and I knew that at some point I would have to face it. But this, while this was happening, several months into dealing with this, I also learned that my wife at the time had went outside the marriage.
Was having an affair.
And was not only having an affair, but was pregnant.
Got pregnant.
And that was extremely devastating.
How long had you been married?
We were high school sweethearts.
Wow.
Yeah. We were high school, so I was a senior in high school when we started dating. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When I had my heart attack, I was 38, so.
Right. Almost 20 year relationship.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You, total shock?
It was a surreal experience. I was in complete denial. It couldn't have been true. It was so surreal to me that I remember having a conversation with the person that she had an affair with. It was actually my son's basketball coach. And I had decided to meet with him to see if in fact that was true. Because I was in disbelief.
How did you first find out?
Through him. He told me. I talk about that in my book. It was very soap opera-like. I found out through him, and because I had some suspicion, because there had been some type of relationship in the past, and every time I was around practice and my wife was there, it was just an odd, inexplicable feeling that I had.
Energy. Kind of.
There was an energy. Mm-hmm. It was an energy mm-hmm. that I couldn't sort out.
Mm-hmm.
And so I decided to speak with him, and he told me, that he had been having an affair for close to a year, and I couldn't believe it, and he said, there's worse. And I said, what is it? She's pregnant. So, and this is all, this is Murphy's Law at its best.
Absolutely.
If anything bad that could happen, it happened.
Yeah.
And so now I'm dealing with two huge, devastating blows.
I only want to take you where you're comfortable with
that. Yeah, of course.
Okay. But you have that conversation with him.
Yeah.
In the gym, somewhere else?
On the phone. And then we actually meet in person. And again, I was accompanied by my rock, my brother.
Yeah. Now, when you're going to talk to him in person, he's told you what the deal is.
Yeah.
Okay. Have you said anything to your wife yet before you go to see him?
No. No, I didn't speak to my wife. It was a short conversation. I remember my brother telling me, let's just get out of here. You got what you need to know. You got the information that you need. Let's go. He's mm-hmm. not worth it. You don't realize it now. These were his words. You don't realize it now, but this man has done you a tremendous favor.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he has. Because I talk about relationships in my book,
yes.
and I talk about how she was a good woman. I've known her for a long time. But it's unfortunate that as we all get older, our interests start to evolve, and sometimes they evolve in different areas. And slowly, partners start moving away in different directions. Mm-hmm. in their lives, in their aspirations.
Mm-hmm.
And when this happens and there's not complete agreement, when there's a discord that's there's this negative energy that starts to evolve. There's this mm-hmm. elephant in the room that no one wants to address, mm-hmm. this Cold War.
Mm-hmm.
And the relationship starts to fester.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not necessarily just arguments, but it starts off with not holding hands, not going out on dates, not speaking with each other,
mm-hmm.
Almost being there just because we have children together.
Hmm.
So when I say that what that man had done for me was a positive and not a negative, I really mean that, because the relationship had festered to the point where I had lost who I was, and I think she had lost who she was.
Mm-hmm.
It's unfortunate that it had to end that way, but it was moving in that direction
Let me ask a personal question.
Yeah.
Because, you know, when you talk about relationships, which you do in your book, do you feel in retrospect that it's generally said that somebody in a relationship loves somebody more than the other person loves back. Do you feel that exists?
You know, I think that love can be demonstrated in a number of different ways. Mm-hmm. And what's ostensible to one partner as showing love is reciprocated, but not necessarily in the same exact way. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I think love is there, because if once the love is gone, that's when things will slowly start to fester. And once this discord starts to brew, it's just a matter of time where there's going to be a divide. And the very moment that you start walking out your relationship, I'm confident to say that things have been brewing for some time, and that's mm-hmm. simply the culmination mm-hmm. of what's been going on for a lengthy period of time, mm-hmm. months, even years.
Right.
And that's what I chalked up her actions to, that there was a divide, that we weren't seeing eye to eye on a lot of things. Mm-hmm. But I stayed nonetheless, even though I didn't feel that the love on any front was being reciprocated. Mm-hmm. And I talk about that in my book mm-hmm. too, because I come from a single parent home.
Yeah.
And I distinctly recall making a pact with my mom,
yeah.
saying that when I'm married and
yeah.
when I have children, I'll never leave. Because the impact that it have on me, I would never want to have that impact on my children.
Mm-hmm.
So despite mm-hmm. the discord,
mm-hmm.
I remained in the marriage.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't until finding out this terrible news that I realized that I'm gonna have to break the promise that I made to my mother.
Yeah. You know, that is, you know, amongst guys in the barbershop.
Yeah.
You know, that is the ultimate betrayal.
Ultimate.
Of a relationship. And a humiliation. Now, I think, I don't have statistics at hand, but the reverse is normally true more so than it is more the man that steps out and gets into that kind of hot water than it is the woman. And so therefore, I think in some psychological way, women are more prepared to deal with that kind of trauma than men are. Men, on the other hand, another man been with my woman, and not just been with her, but that got her pregnant, it's like the ultimate male humiliation.
It was. I felt terribly. I can't deny that. There was no doubt that I went through a very obvious time of depression. It was very difficult for me.
Yeah.
My only reprieve at the time was going to work and helping people, but even more significant to that were my children, my two boys.
Yeah.
Just being around them, being involved in their activities, holding them, hugging them, made me realize that I have to stay strong. So it was tough. There was no doubt that I dealt with clinical depression, a bout of clinical depression. But fortunately, I came out of it.
Mm-hmm.
I did come out of it.
Was the coming out of it a gradual? Was there a light bulb moment?
You know, I gotta tell you, it's odd to say it, but you know, I briefly talk about spirituality and mm-hmm. interconnectedness with the world in my book.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I mention is that sometimes the most horrible things happen to you.
Mm-hmm.
And while it's happening, you may not realize its significance in your life,
mm-hmm.
But it humbles you.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes you realize that there's something outside of your space that's working on your behalf to make you better.
Mm-hmm.
And when this happened to me, there was, again, it was just a series of things. Now, I could chalk this up to divine intervention or simply good luck, whatever it may be. A number of good things started happening after that pitfall.
Somewhere there's an adage, I think, that applies, that hurts you, that crushes you, but that you don't allow to destroy you makes you stronger.
Yeah, I agree. Out of my greatest vulnerabilities came one of my biggest strengths.
Mm-hmm. And that is what?
That is doing what I'm doing right now. Mm-hmm. Writing a book, doing TV, doing radio, sharing my message, helping people, making me realize that what all this culminated to was me identifying what my calling is, and mm-hmm. that is to be an emissary for health and wellness to the world. Mm-hmm. You know, I could talk about that. You know, we're very unfit globally, but in this country as a nation, and my experience made me realize that if I could have developed a heart attack being as fit as I was, mm-hmm. and this didn't happen to me, and this nonetheless happened to me, mm-hmm. there must be something else to health. And so now my main focus outside of my children and working in the office is sharing my message and teaching people that wellness it encompasses a number of things, and diet and exercise are huge. Mm-hmm. I'm not trivializing that. Mm-hmm. What you eat determines your internal chemistry, and that affects everything mm-hmm. in your body. So that's a huge portion of your overall wellness. But it's not just that. That would be very monolithic in your frame of mind of what you think wellness is. Mm-hmm. Exercise, equally important. Mm-hmm. Stress management, though, is critical. Mm-hmm. Stress management is critical.
Let's talk about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I mean, I wanted, you have these five pillars in here, man. I was excited to have you here. You know, because I'm paying attention.
Great.
And so I want to talk about your five pillows, but you just mentioned stress management and you put real emphasis on it. Tell us your remedy for managing stress.
Well, the unfortunate truth is that all of us, day to day, are bombarded by a number of different stressors. We've evolved with a protective mechanism to keep us alive in the event of a crisis. Mm-hmm. And this protective mechanism is a fight or flight, right? Mm-hmm. So if a child were under a car, we've all heard these stories. You sometimes see a mother or a grandmother lifting the car. Mm-hmm. That's attributable to her being in this fight or flight state. Mm-hmm. Or if an animal is being chased by his or her predator, they would immediately get into this fight or flight state. Mm-hmm. A number of neurological and hormonal things start happening, and that's what keeps us alive.
Right.
The thing is that in this modern world that we live in, we have so many stressors, from simple things.
Traffic,
getting up late.
Yeah.
Finding out that your boss knows that you're late, meeting a deadline, yeah. It could be anything. Mm-hmm. Your children not getting up on time to go to school, or mm-hmm. they're not eating their dinner. There's so many different types of stressors, but your body, for the most part, indiscriminately responds to stress as if it's a life or death situation, a crisis. Mm-hmm. And when this stress response that we've evolved to have, this fight or flight response, becomes chronic and persistent, it starts to wreak havoc in our body. Mm-hmm. And the havoc that it wreaks is statistically linked with so many diseases, mm-hmm. heart disease being one of them. Mm-hmm. The more stressed you out, the higher the likelihood of disease. Mm-hmm. The more isolation you have, the more the likelihood of heart disease.
So let me ask you about the stress, because the stress, the flight or fight, mm-hmm. Folks deal with it in different ways.
Yeah.
And how one deals with it can have a very negative effect on their health.
Yes.
And I want to give an example. I think that I deal with stress sometimes. Well, I want to go have some fried chicken. And that's not good.
Well, there is comfort. There food does mitigate stress hormones. So there mm-hmm. is science to linking how certain foods, particularly carbohydrates, does mm-hmm. blunt the stress response.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I mean, when I say potato salad, I mean I didn't finish. I didn't finish the mashed potatoes or the potato salad or the cornbread.
Yeah. But the thing is that we're bombarded with it on such a regular basis,
yeah.
from morning to night,
right.
that if we don't do something on a daily basis,
mm-hmm.
and you know, for years I used to think of meditation, for example, as being hokey pokey.
Mm-hmm.
That's for those guys, those people that live on the West Coast, the tree hugging people.
Chantless, right.
But it made me open up my eyes and realize that there's a lot to be said about down regulating the nervous system.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you could take meditation, you could take prayer, you could do yoga, you could do Tai Chi.
That term again is down regulating.
So when you're in this fight or flight state,
yeah.
your nervous system is upregulated.
Yeah.
You're ultra aware, your consciousness is elevated.
Yeah.
Your cortisol starts going up. Mm-hmm. You start having different hormones.
So managing that
is what needs to be stressed, because mm-hmm. when you have chronic and perpetual cortisol and epinephrine and all these fast acting hormones mm-hmm. that upregulate your nervous system,
mm-hmm.
and it stays, you have these transient episodes throughout the day, that starts to break down your body's organs.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you need to do preemptively, even when you don't encounter stress,
mm-hmm.
is to down-regulate.
Mm-hmm.
You know what's a great way? And it's another pillar of health? Sleep.
Mm-hmm.
Sleep. We don't get enough sleep.
Yeah.
But, you know, we need 7 to 9 hours of sleep, because that helps to down-regulate you, to engage a different part of the nervous system that's more restorative.
Mm-hmm.
That part of the nervous system is called the parasympathetic nervous system. Mm-hmm. But during the day, you could get it with simple prayer or simply deep breathing. I teach all of my patients box breathing.
What's that?
So box breathing is one of the many different techniques that could be used to calm your nervous system, to down-regulate your body.
Mm-hmm.
And what that means is that you breathe in for 4 seconds, hold it for 4 seconds, breathe out for 4 seconds, hold it for 4 seconds,
mm-hmm.
and repeat.
Mm-hmm.
As you exhale, you engage the part of the nervous system that's calming,
mm-hmm.
that's peaceful and calming.
Mm-hmm. Managing stress then?
That's managing stress.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's managing stress.
Okay.
Because once you start once you notice that you start breathing from your shoulders,
yeah.
that's called apical breathing.
Yeah.
Once your pulse starts going up,
mm-hmm.
that's an indication. And we have so many different biofeedback markers nowadays. You know, mm-hmm. we have Fitbits, mm-hmm. and you could even just check your pulse. But we have so many mechanisms to tell you what your body and its functions are doing,
mm-hmm.
that it's easier than it was before. But once you notice that your pulse is being elevated, you're breathing heavy, you're breathing through your shoulders, that's a direct indication that you're in this fight or flight state.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not in a crisis, if you don't have to run away from someone that's chasing you, there's no need to be in this state.
And
this is why you want to engage in anything that is suitable to you. Some people like to do yoga, and I think yoga is great.
Mm-hmm.
And I do my fair share of it, but my go-to, and this is my personal bias, is mm-hmm. I like deep breathing, because mm-hmm. it's simple,
mm-hmm.
and I could do it in the morning, mm-hmm. upon waking up, during the day, when I encounter stressful episodes, mm-hmm. and then at night before I go to bed.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about some of the other pillars.
Yeah. So the 5 pillars of wellness are diet,
mm-hmm.
exercise, stress management,
mm-hmm.
sleep, and then the mindset that one needs when they're embarking on a journey of health and wellness.
Mm-hmm. Let's start there.
Okay.
Because if we're embarking, first journey of 1,000 miles, you got to take that first step.
Right.
Take that first step, the greater chance of success is having the proper mindset. Explain.
So one of the things that I talk about when I'm working with my patients, mm-hmm. with my clients, I offer a transformation program, and I take them through 6 weeks of employing these pillars. And when I talk about, and in the very first week, I talk about the mindset, because without the mindset, you're not going to last the duration of 6 weeks. And in this webinar that I provide to my clients, I talk about the need to be action oriented. Mm-hmm. You know, you could be motivated, mm-hmm. but if there is no action that accompanies that motivation, mm-hmm. it goes in vain. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that I talk about is to immortalize your thoughts, meaning you put it down on paper, you write down mm-hmm. a things to do list. Mm-hmm. And if you write things down, mm-hmm. you're more apt to do this mm-hmm. list. Mm-hmm. And there's a feeling of euphoria when at the end of the day, you know that you've checked off everything that you needed mm-hmm. to do.
The difference from checking that off to deciding that you're gonna go on a diet and exercise program on the first of the month, not writing it down, and you don't do it, you have that opposite effect.
That's right.
I've experienced that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so creating that right mind frame.
Creating the mind frame, knowing what to expect, mm-hmm. Creating a social network of people that are like-minded. Mm-hmm. When you're in a network of people that are like-minded, it's easier to be compliant. Mm-hmm. Immortalizing things on paper, it's easier to be compliant. Mm-hmm. Committing to one thing only, your keystone habit, is powerful, because if you decide, you know what, I'm just gonna go into the gym. Mm-hmm. That's my things to do list. Mm-hmm. I haven't thought what I'm gonna do exactly when I go to the gym, mm-hmm. or I'm gonna go to my basement after work,
yeah.
knowing that there's a gym there, some yeah. type of equipment. Mm-hmm. Just doing that oftentimes will lead to other healthier habits. Mm-hmm. So the strong likelihood is that just driving to the gym, you're gonna do something. Mm-hmm. And something is better than nothing. Now I could elaborate a lot more than that. Definitely you wanna be more efficient mm-hmm. with your time. Mm-hmm. But when you develop a keystone habit, usually other things will happen. People that exercise, for example, eat healthier. Mm-hmm. People that exercise often drink more water throughout the course of the day. Mm-hmm. So commit to one habit first, mm-hmm. and you'll develop a periphery of other healthy habits. Mm-hmm. And write those things on paper and surround yourself with like-minded people. Identify stressors, identify things that are gonna impede your progress. Mm-hmm. It could be anything. It could mm-hmm. be a person, place, mm-hmm. or thing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So identify those things and move away from
Stay away from it.
So mm-hmm. it could be a bakery. Stay mm-hmm. away from the bakery. Mm-hmm. It could be a friend that doesn't like to work out or is a cynic about exercise.
Yeah.
You may want to stay away from him. You may want to hang out with someone that is pro-exercise, that is pro-wellness and mm-hmm. health.
Before, I want to examine a little bit this webinar, this six-week thing that you put folks through, program that you put folks through. But before I do that, I want to ask you, has your workout and diet changed pre-operation to post-operation?
Not at all. Mm-hmm. Not at all. That wasn't the problem.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
That wasn't the problem. Mm-hmm. In order to manifest health and wellness externally, you have to cultivate health and wellness internally. Mm-hmm. I've always been a big proponent of understanding human movement, because that's what I do day to day.
Sure.
As a doctor of physical therapy, as a mm-hmm. teacher, I talk about movement every day. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until after my experience that I realized that biochemistry is precursory to biomechanics. Mm-hmm. So you need to know what's happening on a cellular level in order to appreciate what's happening on a macro level. Mm-hmm. And so my diet and exercise didn't change, but it wasn't until I probed my blood work after my event that I realized that I did in fact have markers, subclinical markers, that would have increased the likelihood of me developing heart disease. Uh-huh. And so the way you manage those inflammatory markers, these subclinical markers, mm-hmm. is by employing other lifestyle changes. So my diet and exercise stayed the same, mm-hmm. but I added the other components of the five, you know, these other three pillars,
yeah.
to address those things. Mm-hmm. And so my diet and exercise are for the most part the same, but in order to eliminate inflammation, right? Those are the markers that I'm referring to. Mm-hmm. For some of the audience that may be familiar with the subclinical markers, they're like C-reactive protein, homocysteine, fibrinogen,
right.
things that aren't routinely checked for. Mm-hmm. You definitely want to check for it, especially if you have a family history. But these markers indicate inflammation on a cellular level, mm-hmm. that predispose you to a number of diseases, heart disease being one of them. Mm-hmm. And while my diet was conducive to lower this subclinical inflammation, mm-hmm. there were other things that was causing inflammation. Mm-hmm. Stress is one of them. Mm-hmm. So that's why I put a big part of my book and my lifestyle modifications to managing stress. Mm-hmm. And you do that through daily activities, and then nocturnal activities, particularly ritualizing sleep and making sure that you're getting the right amount of sleep and the right quality of sleep.
You know, this mindset thing is in part how you talk to yourself.
Yeah.
Things that you say. And I have a young lady who's anybody's observation would be a very attractive 18-year-old intern. And I heard her say something the other day, and I started to address it. But instead of me addressing it, I invited her to the show here today.
Okay.
And I'm gonna talk to you about what she said. I asked her, did she like soul food? So she said, well, you know, I'm a fat girl. And she's really not. She's really not. She's somebody that a whole bunch of boys would want to take to the prom.
I bet.
Not, you know, not Twiggy, but somebody that a whole bunch of boys would want to take to the prom. And so she said, do I like soul food? Yeah, well, I'm a fat girl, you know. So now, in terms of talking to yourself, I would think that that might be language that you would say to her. That's not the language and how to speak to yourself.
You know, there's a lot to be said about self-perception. If in fact her self-perception is that she is big, that she's overweight, then that's something that needs to be addressed. Negative self-talk is in and of itself a form of stress that mm-hmm. could debilitate you and could impede your progress on being healthy and being well. Mm-hmm. But if it was a tongue-in-cheek comment, I wouldn't make too much,
you know,
of it.
I think it was a half joke, but my dad used to say many true words spoke in a joke.
Yeah. The occasional cheat meal mm-hmm. is not bad. Mm-hmm. I think the big problem, if I had an opportunity to speak with her, I would say one meal in and of itself is not bad, what you want to when you're looking at your diet, you want to look at it in the vastness of the course of the month. It's not so much that one particular meal, but everything else that you're doing, mm-hmm. diet and outside of diet, mm-hmm. that's contributing to either optimal health mm-hmm. or disease. Mm-hmm. And the unfortunate truth is that in this country, we don't have health care. We have disease care.
Yeah.
We treat people once they manifest disease. Mm-hmm. And disease and optimal wellness are far ends of the spectrum. Mm-hmm. And so, okay, she could be very well and have an occasional cheat meal. That's fine. But if you're just, you know, sweet potatoes and macaroni and cheese and fried chicken with soda a meal away from developing diabetes, you may want to watch
yeah.
that out.
Yeah.
So you want to be optimally well before you could justify having those meals mm-hmm. every once in a while. Mm-hmm. But if you're overweight, if you're pre-diabetic, if you're hypertensive, you have no reason to be eating like that. Mm-hmm. You haven't earned eating bread. You haven't earned eating pasta.
Your book is Courage to Continue. Your brother mentions in here, he said, my brother is as beautiful on the inside as he is on the outside. I'd like to give that beautiful brother 1 minute to speak to what has been your inspiration, and that's your two kids. We're going to give you a clip of this entire show, and I want your kids to be able to see what you said on the Rock Newman Show about them being your inspiration. Now we have only 30 seconds.
My kids are everything. You know, they are my light. They are my motivation, my driving force, and they keep me aspirational. I work hard because of them. I want to provide them the best opportunities that I wasn't provided when I was young. So thank you, boys. Thank you for being in my life. You give me some hard times, but you give me a lot of hope, love, and I love you in my life.
Thank you, man.
Thanks.
I'm glad you came here
Thanks.
Today.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.